Hello everyone, this is Neil Davis from Digital Cloud Training. In this video, I'm going to walk you through some practice questions for the AWS Certified Cloud Practitioner exam. Now, these questions represent some of the latest topics that come up in the exam. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to make sure that I give you some of the strategy behind how to answer exam questions. So even if you get stuck and you don't necessarily know the correct answer, you can use some of these strategies to eliminate the incorrect answers and make sure that you get some more points towards your certification. Now, there will be another part to this next week, so make sure you like and subscribe if you want to get notified for the next upcoming video that's going to walk you through some more practice questions for this exam, and then subsequently we'll go into some of the other certifications as well. Okay, so here is my first question. A company is launching a new website which is expected to have highly variable levels of traffic. The website will run on Amazon EC2 and it needs to be highly available. What's the most effective approach? Okay, so the key words here are that the workload is highly variable. So we can expect that at some times there's going to be high load, lots of demand for the application. At other times there's less load. Now, when there's less load, we obviously don't want as much resources allocated to it because that's going to cost money. So we want to be able to dynamically respond. So let's walk through. I'm just going to start at the first answer here and then walk further down. So the first one is use the AWS CLI to launch and terminate EC2 instances to match demand. So we could use the command line interface. Certainly possible, but that sounds very manual. I don't really want things to be manual. Always think automated in AWS. We always want to try and reduce the amount of manual intervention. We don't really want someone monitoring and seeing what the performance is like and then making changes. We just want it to happen automatically. The second answer here is create an Amazon EC2 auto scaling group and configure elastic load balancing. Okay, so that variable piece that we were talking about, that is covered by auto scaling. So that is definitely a great solution here. That's an automatic way that we can respond to changes in the demand for our application based on performance metrics. Auto-scaling measures performance metrics like the amount of CPU that's being utilized, and then it can respond and launch and terminate instances. Now, the other piece here is that we want this to be highly available. That's also there in the question. So the second piece is covered by elastic load balancing. So I like this answer. The load balancer will distribute traffic. So now we have high availability because the instances can be deployed across multiple availability zones. That's effectively separate data centers. So I like the second answer. I'm going to select that answer, but let's just check. Never move on until you're absolutely sure that all of the other answers are definitely not the right one. Don't just stick to an answer and not read through all of them carefully. The next one is determine the highest expected traffic and use an appropriate instance type. That basically means we're going to look at what the worst case is, or the best case if you like, where our application is being highly utilized by our customers, and what would be the performance requirements for that particular workload, and then we're going to utilize an instance type for that. The problem is that's going to mean that we're going to spend more money because sometimes we don't need that level of resource. So I don't like that answer. Last one is launch the website using an EC2 instance running on a dedicated host. This is not a use case for dedicated hosts. Dedicated hosts is where you actually have a physical host server in AWS dedicated to your workload. There's a variety of reasons for doing that, including having an extra level of control over the placement of your instances. But we don't need that for this particular question. So I like the second answer. Let's submit that one. Of course, that is correct. And there's a nice sort of image here of auto-scaling in action with the ASG monitoring the metrics coming through the CloudWatch service and then launching and terminating instances. So let's move on to the next question. A user has limited knowledge of AWS services but wants to quickly deploy a scalable Node.js application in an Amazon VPC. Which service should be used? Okay, fairly simple scenario. We just need to find a way of, I guess, making it easier for somebody to deploy an application running on Node.js. So what we want there, we want EC2. We could use containers as well, but you probably need a little bit more AWS knowledge for containers. And there's no actual answer here that mentions Amazon ECS or AWS Fargate. So what we do have CloudFormation. CloudFormation automatically builds infrastructure based on code. Okay, that's great for deploying infrastructure, but is it a great way to deploy a Node.js application? Elastic Beanstalk is the next one there, and Elastic Beanstalk definitely stands out immediately as the best answer here because it is exactly for that purpose. It's about not just bringing up an EC2 instance that's being managed by AWS, lots of the operational and the monitoring is being managed, but also it can have those frameworks for the application on top. So Node.js in this example, which essentially means you end up with what's called a platform as a service solution or a PaaS solution. So I like that second answer. That does seem to be something which would be applicable to this scenario. In fact, there's two real main use cases here. This one is for a user with limited knowledge, and it does work in that scenario because it's very straightforward to go through the Beanstalk console and deploy a stack on which Node.js is running, and you just upload your code and it will deploy the code. The other use case, which is very common, is for developers, because developers love Beanstalk because they just don't want to, you know, manage the underlying EC2 or the Node.js framework. They just want to deploy their code. So for this one, I like number two again. EC2 on its own, not necessarily, because you have to install the various frameworks, you have to manage it yourself, so not as good for somebody with limited knowledge. And lastly here, we have Amazon LightSail. LightSail is it's essentially like a cut down version of EC2. It's a cheaper way to run operating systems like Windows and Linux in the cloud. It doesn't have the full suite of features you get with EC2, and it's not a platform as a service solution. So it doesn't give the ability to deploy a scalable Node.js application or to have full VPC connectivity. So Beanstalk, I think, is the best answer. And sure enough, that is the best answer. Of course, we can use other frameworks as well, like Java, .NET, PHP, Python, Ruby Go, and even Docker containers. So let's move on to the third question. A company is building a serverless workflow that coordinates multiple AWS services into a reliable application, and they want a visual workflow that can track the status of each step in the application. Which service would facilitate creating this kind of workflow? So we always have to look for keywords when we approach these questions. And the one that really stands out for me here is visual workflow. Okay, because there's a variety of ways that we can coordinate services. As you'll know, there's so much power in AWS. We can use event-driven architectures. We can use services like EventBridge. We've got notification services and message buses. There's lots of ways that we can connect services together and coordinate them into a serverless application. But here, the visual workflow is a good keyword that pushes me towards step functions. Now, it is the second answer again, so looks like we got a bit of a pattern here, but don't let that get you in the exam because it really doesn't mean anything. It just so happens that in this case, three questions in a row have number two as the correct answer, or at least I think so at this point. So step functions is a way of coordinating. So it's essentially orchestrating multiple AWS Lambda functions into an application. And critically, it does have that visual workflow. So there's a visual way that you can represent in Amazon State language the workflow of your application. And it basically has logic in it that does things like if, then, else. Now, AWS Lambda is a serverless service, but it doesn't give you a visual workflow for coordinating multiple components of the application, which step functions does. SNS is the simple notification service. That's part of event-driven architecture. But again, it doesn't have the visual workflow. And so it's not really for coordinating multiple services. It's not really an orchestration service. And lastly, we have the Amazon Simple Queue service, which is a message bus. So SQS is a way that we can decouple our applications and place messages into a queue for later consumption by another service component, but it doesn't have a workflow for coordination here. We have to build that into our services like Lambda or EC2 or ECS, where we're consuming the messages, and it doesn't have a visual workflow either. So I'm sticking with step functions. So of course, that is the correct answer. Let's move on to question four. Which service provides a fully managed third-party file system with native compatibility and a rich feature set to be used with a broad range of AWS services? So here, the critical thing again is to work out what are those keywords here. Third-party file systems is very important. So I'm going to look through these and try and work out which one makes the most sense. And let's just start at the top and work down. Firstly, we've got the Amazon Elastic File System. So EFS is used with Linux servers. It's a way of connecting using the NFS protocol to the EFS file system. Now, it's not a third-party file system. This one is an AWS technology that uses the NFS, which is a standard protocol for access. Now, Storage Gateway gives us multiple options for how we can connect. We can use NFS and we can use SMB and different ways that we can store the data, either cached in an on-premises data center, or it can be in the cloud, and then we actually are connecting through from an on-premises data center, but it's for hybrid storage connectivity. Then we've got the Amazon Simple Storage Service, S3. Again, it's not third party, it's AWS technology here, and this is an object-based storage system. So I've eliminated all those three, and the last one is FSx. Now, FSx does provide third-party file systems, so we can run Microsoft file systems, and we can run Lustre file systems, and there's a few other now as well. I think NetApp ONTAP is in there. So let's select the FSx option, click Submit, and sure enough, that is the correct answer, and it gives us Windows File Server and Lustre. And as I mentioned, there's a few newer options as well for the FSx service. Moving on to question 5, which service allows you to securely share your resources across AWS accounts or within your organization, helping you to reduce operational overhead and to centrally manage access to the shared resources? Okay, so there's quite a lot in this question. Firstly, the key thing here is we're trying to share resources. Now, across accounts or within an organization. So in other words, it's going to be across accounts that are independent, or it's going to be across accounts that are within an AWS organization structure. And we want to be able to reduce operational overhead. So just make things easier. We don't have too much maintenance to actually incur here in deploying and then the ongoing management of this solution. And we want central management of the shared resources. Now, we've got AWS organizations as the first option. Organizations is a way that we can connect multiple accounts and have central management of those accounts. So we have a management account and then we have member accounts. Organizations is the top of the hierarchy. It's kind of the central point of control. And we can use things like service control policies then to apply the restrictions on which API actions are allowed within the member accounts. So we've got that centralized control. And it also gives additional abilities as well. Like as it says here, we're looking for a way to share resources across accounts or within organizations. So organizations is a potential component of the solution, but it's not the actual technology that's going to allow us to share the resources. So it's not going to be organizations. Identity and access management is for permissions and for users and roles and groups. And so it's a way of authentication and then access control. So we authenticate and then we get authorized to perform certain actions in AWS. So that is another critical piece to this. We need to be able to authenticate and be authorized to have access to whichever resources, but it's not the service that's going to allow us to share. Then we've got service catalog. Service catalog is a way of publishing pre-configured applications so that users can then consume them. They can then order them from the catalog. So it's not that one either. The last one I like, Resource Access Manager. So Resource Access Manager, or AWS RAM, is a way that we can share resources like subnets in a VPC across accounts, and organizations can help us facilitate that as well. So the last one here is RAM. Let's submit RAM, and that is the correct answer. So that is the best service here for sharing resources across accounts. Now, the last question for this particular video, a company is looking to develop a conversational chatbot that can interact dynamically with its customers through a natural language interface. Which service should be used to facilitate this? So we have a few services here in the machine learning category. And so what we need to do is work out which one is the correct service for a chatbot. With some of these machine learning services, we can work out a little bit about what they do based on the name. So we've got Amazon Transcribe. That's about transcription. We got Textract, which is extracting handwriting and other textual elements from documents. We got Comprehend, which pulls insights out of documents. So it uses natural language processing to do that. So just by understanding those services, I now am left with one, which doesn't really give away exactly what it is, but it's called Amazon Lex. And that one is the conversational chatbot. So I like the first option here. I'm going to submit Amazon Lex, and that is the correct answer. So that's it for this video. I hope that was useful to you. Make sure you like and subscribe if you want to see more videos like this. We've got plenty more coming up soon.